بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على نبيه محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أجمعين. أما بعد، on this blessed night, alhamdulillah, we have a very essential topic to understand related to tazkiyah. And this topic is the clarification or the distinction between the tazkiyah of Salafiyah and the tazkiyah of Sufiyah. We have, mashallah ta'ala, a very high-powered panel for that discussion. We have on my far left, our beloved Sheikh Ali Al-Halabi. Well, Sheikh Ali, I think most people here know about him, but for perhaps the one or two people who might not, I shall mention very briefly about him. Well, Sheikh Ali Al-Halabi has the good fortune of being one of the many students of the great scholar of hadith and other related sciences, Sheikh Muhammad Nasruddin Albani. Well, Sheikh Ali, alhamdulillah, has been a student of Sheikh Albani for around 20 years now. And he is still among the students of Sheikh Muhammad Nasruddin Albani. Well, Sheikh Ali brings good knowledge, good sound knowledge in the matters of Aqidah, wa Hadith and its related sciences, and Minhaj and Fiqh. And he has written numerous books on Islam, and he's active in the Dawah, and alhamdulillah, he's visited America a number of times for Dawah, wa jazakallahu khair. Next, and not meaning next in stature, but just next sitting to him, on the right of Sheikh Ali, is our beloved Sheikh and elder, Sheikh Muhammad Safwat Nuruddin. Well, Sheikh Muhammad Safwat Nuruddin is from Egypt, and he is the Rais, or the President, of an organization called Ansar al-Sunnah. And this is the same organization that we mentioned earlier, or I think yesterday, that the other Sheikh, Saeed Abdul Halim, belongs to. Well, Sheikh Safwat Nuruddin is the Rais of this organization. It's a very active Dawah organization in Egypt. And as I mentioned, it is the eldest or the oldest existing Salafi organization upon the earth that I know of that has been in continuous existence for around 70 or some odd years now. Well, Sheikh Safwat Nuruddin has also an author, and he also is the chief editor of a magazine published in Egypt called Tawheed Magazine, or as it could be translated as, inshallah. Next to him, we have our brother, our beloved translator, Yahya, from Toronto, and may Allah Ta'ala give him the strength to keep up with this high power. And also here present, of course, and I think he also actually needs no introduction, our beloved brother Sheikh Muhammad Saeed Ali. He's the Imam of Masjid al-Muslimin in Columbia, South Carolina. As I mentioned, I think the Sheikh, we know, is very active in Dawah, and jazakallah khair for him also. He has traveled widely through North America giving Dawah. He's originally from Egypt. He studied in the Deen in Mecca and also in Egypt. And now he is Muhammad Ali and Bani Muhammad Ali, because he has a tribe. He has his own tribe that he started in South Carolina. Maybe he'll tell us about that sometime. So inshallah ta'ala, we're going to start now. Jazakallah khair.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. أما بعد, verily all praise and glory is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is due to him and none other. We praise him and we seek his forgiveness and we ask him for his mercy. And we testify and we state that there is no God or deity worthy of any type of worship but Allah, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a servant and final messenger. I remind you and myself of the verse in Surah Ali Imran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala advises us by saying, O ye who believe, fear Allah the fear that he is most deserving of you, and do not die unless you are in the state of al-Islam. And as to what follows, it is a great honor to be sitting amongst some of the great ulama, some of the great talabat ilm that may be alive on the face of the earth with us in these days. So without further ado, I give you, first of all, Sheikh Abu al-Harith Ali Hassan al-Halabi to introduce and to speak about our important topic for today, which is at-tazkiyah, or the differences or the clarification between the tazkiyah of the Salafiyin and the tazkiyah of the Sufiyin. فليتفضل مشكورا.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. إن موضوع مقارنة التزكية بين منهج أهل السنة بين منهج السلفية ومنهج الصوفية موضوع مهم جدا، لأن به يعرف كل مسلم حقيقة ما يجب عليه معرفته من أن الدعوة السلفية دعوة شاملة وليست دعوة جزئية وليست دعوة كما يقول بعض الأدعياء دعوة جافة، إنما هي في الحقيقة دعوة الإسلام الشاملة، دعوة التزكية ودعوة التصفية والتربية.
The Sheikh began by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending peace and blessings upon the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He introduces the topic by saying, our discussion today between or through the clarification of the tazkiyah of the Sufiyya and the tazkiyah of the Salafiyya is a discussion that is important for us to understand and to know the clarifying points about, to clarify the concepts and the misconcepts that may be involved with them. Today we will show that the da'wah of the Salafiyya, and we will portray it as being the true da'wah, complete and perfect, for it is the da'wah of al-Islam. It is the da'wah of al-Islam in its completeness.
وها هنا استحضار حسن لبيت من الشعر يعرف من خلاله حقيقة هذين الشيئين اللذين يراد المقارنة بينهما أو الموازنة لهما، وذلك قول الشاعر: ألم تر أن السيف ينقص قدره إذا قيل إن السيف أمضى من العصا، فهل تقارن البدعة بالسنة؟ وهل يقارن الضلال بالهدى؟ وهل يقارن الانحراف عن الحق بسلوك الجادة القويمة؟ أقول: الأصل ألا يقارن ذاك بهذا، ولكن لما كان هنالك انحراف في الفهم وانحراف في التصور وانحراف في السلوك كان لا بد من ذكر هذه المقارنة حتى يتميز أهل الحق بحقهم، وحتى يعلو بما امتن الله تبارك وتعالى به عليهم من ثبات وسداد واستقامة وشمولية في الدعوة والتصور، الدعوة للكتاب والسنة، والتصور التام لما عليه سلف الأمة في فهم كتاب ربهم وسنة نبيهم صلى الله عليه وسلم.
The Sheikh began by saying it is now befitting for us to recite some poetry. And obviously, you know, this is going to be very difficult to translate word for word poetry. But I will give you what the main concept of the poem was speaking about, which is to know the difference between two things. It is important to understand their concepts. For instance, you must understand what bid'ah is in order for you to understand what sunnah is, or to understand sunnah before you will understand what bid'ah is. And also, if you are in dalal, you have to know al-huda to know its opposite. So this is what the poem, I think, was trying to clarify. And then the Sheikh, supporting the use of the poem, he says, it is important for us in our discussion today to portray and to show the misconceptions and the misactions and the misbeliefs that certain people may have. And this is only going to be found by showing what the truth is. And this is why the Sheikh is going to explain to us what the Quran and the Sunnah and what the Sahaba and the Tabi'een understood them as and implemented them as will be shown to us following right now.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وسلم. فإن الإسلام بصفائه ونقائه وكماله وجماله هو الشرع الذي بعث به رب العزة سائر الأنبياء وجميع المرسلين وختمهم بخيرة خلق الله أجمعين. لكن الشيطان تسلط على الناس ليخرجهم من ذلك الدين بمعولين يهدم عليهما ذلك الأمان الذي التزموه والخير الذي استظلوا به. أما المعول الأول فهو معول الشهوات، يدخلون فيها في أبواب المعاصي، والمكثرين منها هم الفساق. والمعول الثاني معول الشبهات، يدخل عليهم ليفسد عليهم أمر دينهم. والصوفية دخلت على الناس من باب معول الشبهات حتى تخرجهم من الدين وهم لا يعلمون.
Sheikh Safwat now is explaining to us in stating Islam arriving in its completeness, its beauty and its fullness was intended and was sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through all of the prophets from the beginning to the end of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to bring people to the righteousness of al-Islam, to the submission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yet the shaitan came and tried to distract them and to remove them from this goodness, fullness and beauty of al-Islam using two main tools, two weapons against us. Sheikh Safwat began by stating number one was ash-shahawat, lusts, desires, whims that are not allowed for a Muslim, hoping for things that are not permitted in al-Islam. And second, ash-shubuhat, doubtful ideas, doubt, placing doubt in our hearts as to the validity of al-Islam. And this, as Sheikh Safwat points out, is where the Sufism has struck, bringing people and put and placing doubts in their hearts in regards to al-Islam.
دخل طريق الشبهات على الناس مع أن الصوفية عريقة في القدم أفسدت على الناس ديانات من قبل، مخطئ من يظن أن الصوفية نشأت في قرن من قرون الإسلام، لكن الصوفية تجمع بين شبهات عند البوذية والهندوكية، وتجمع إليها شبهات في النصرانية واليهودية، أدخلوها على المسلمين ليفسدوا عليهم أمر دينهم.
The Sheikh states now, and from the Shubuhat, it is important for us to understand that the Sufis, it is not the first time that they are seen in the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is not the first time they have come into a religion to destroy or to change what should have been kept in place. For it has come into the nations, and it is not something native only in al-Islam. For if you look and you see the Buddhist religion or the Hindu religion, even in Christianity and Judaism, you will find this disease in many of its sects and many of its people.
فمثلا إذا أردنا أن ننظر إلى تلك الشبهات التي أدخلوها، لم يستطيعوا أن يردوا القرآن أو يكذبوه، ولكن قالوا القرآن كلام الله لكن له معنى باطن غير ما يفهمه أهل الظاهر، وأدخلوا البدع التي يريدونها تحت اسم العلم الباطل، أدخلوا البدع تحت أسماء أخرى، حتى انطلت على الكثير من الناس. لكن الذي ينبغي أن نحذر منه أنه كلما بعد المسلم عن مركز الإسلام ووفرة علمائه وجودة إتقان حججه وبيناته، كلما كان دخول هذه البدع عليهم أوفر وإليهم أيسر. لذلك فإنه ينبغي أن نحذر إخواننا خاصة في مثل هذه البلاد من دخول فساد التصوف وبدعه عليهم.
The Sheikh continues by saying, an example of this, let us look at the doubts that are being shown or that are being used. You will never find one of them saying, let us change the Quran, or this is not the Quran, or disbelieving in the Quran. No, they will come with the shubha, with the doubt, and say, the Quran has two meanings, an open meaning and an inner meaning. And for you to understand the inner meaning, you have to be from amongst us. And this is where they hide their bid'ah and enter the bid'ah into the mainstream Muslim ummah, disguising it under this shubha, this doubt, into the Muslims. And as such, the Sheikh says, it is important for us to know the farther a Muslim strays from the Muslim nations and the Muslim ulama and the Muslim books and the places of Islamic knowledge, the easier and the quicker it is for these bid'ah and these ideas and these doubts to enter into their mainstream life. And he gives us a special warning from being attracted into such a thing by being used in such a deceptive manner.
بسم الله، الحمد لله، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and send the peace and the blessing on his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I greet you all with the greeting of Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And I asked my elders and my sheikhs to permit me, inshallah, to talk, and this doesn't mean that I'm trying to compete with them or to be in their level. So after Brother Yahya, inshallah, seeking the permission from me, I'll be... Inshallah. جزاك الله خير. As I had stated last night concerning التزكية and the meaning of التزكية, we said this means elevation, it means purification, and we dealt in much details about the meaning of التزكية. In actuality, what I want to convey to you this night is concerning how a Muslim, according the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, according the Quran, how he's supposed to purify himself. And we have three elements which I had touched cases on it last night. And number one was al-tawheed and al-iman. And number two was al-mutaba'a lil-rasuli sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to follow the footsteps of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the third step, which was going to be al-fara'id and the sunan, which is that we carry the obligations from salah and zakah and hajj and all the sunnahs of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that had he recommended. We give example today on the lecture concerning the fasting in Ramadan, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated that kutiba alaykum as-siyam kama kutiba ala alladhina min qablikum la'allakum tattaqun. Therefore, the purpose of fasting is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want to purify our souls, want to teach us taqwa. And by have God conscious, this is one of the, what we're talking about today is about tazkiyah. So inshallah, after the sheikh, they finish talking and compare between Sufism and Salafiyah, I will go more in details about the how we can make tazkiyah by following the footsteps of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah knows best.
ولا بد قبل الخوض في مهمات مسائل هذه الندوة المباركة إن شاء الله، لا بد من ذكر إلماعة متعلقة بعنوانها السلفية أو التزكية بين الصوفية والسلفية. فالتزكية هي التطهير والنماء والإصلاح والزيادة، وقد تكلمنا عليها مرارا، ولا بد أن غير واحد ممن اعتلوا هذه المنصة في هذين اليومين أنه قد تكلم فيها. ولكن لا بد أن نعرف نبذة عن من يقال بأنهم سلفيون، عن معنى هذه النسبة ومدى صحتها وكيف هي، وكذلك الأمر تماما في الصوفية، حتى إذا تكلمنا يكون كلامنا عن علم، عن علم وعن بينة وعن برهان صحيح صريح، لا عن مجرد أمان وظنون أو وظنون وأفكار بعيدة عن المنهجية الصحيحة والتصور الصحيح. فعندما نقول السلفية، السلفية نسبة إلى السلف، وإذا أطلق السلف فإنما يراد بهم السلف الصالح، والسلف الصالح هم أهل القرون الثلاثة المشهود لهم بالخير على لسان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
Our two beloved sheikhs sitting on my left, inshallah, Sheikh Al Halabi and Sheikh Safwat Nur al-Din, they will now discuss with us the differences between al-Salafiyya and the Sufiyya, the tazkiyah between each of the two different groups. Sheikh Ali al-Halabi, he says, before we can dive into the topic, let us first look into the title of our lecture or our nadwa today, which is the tazkiyah, the clarification between the tazkiyah of the Sufiyya and the tazkiyah of the Salafiyya. First, let us understand what this word at-tazkiyah means. He states, we already know that some of us have already spoken even on this same stage in front of you today in explaining it to you. But as a refreshing point, he explains, التزكية comes and he explains it is النمو, it is purifying, it is increasing, it is correcting oneself. And he said this has already been spoken about. He says, let us now look and see and understand what is a Salafi, and who are these people who claim they are Salafi, and what is the origin of this word Salafi, and why do we say it? He says, and we will use proofs. We will not use doubts. We will not use ideas that are far from the truth. We will not use whims and desires. He continues and he says, a Salafi, it is just derived from the word Salaf, specifically a Salaf al-Salih. The pious predecessors or the generations who have come before us, specifically the three blessed generations that the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam with his own tongue has given the seal of approval, as you would say, as naming them the rightly guided or the guided times, the best of times that the Muslims have seen.
وعندما نقول السلفية فإننا نريد بذلك الإسلام، ليس شيء غير الإسلام وليس شيء سوى الإسلام، وإنما النسبة إلى السلف في الإسلام لأن الإسلام على مر الأزمان قد داخلته شوائب واختلطت به بدع ومنكرات كان لابد للتخلص منها والبعد عنها من الرجوع الى الجيل الفريد الاول الذي اليه المرجع والمعول، حيث فهم ذلك الجيل الاسلام فهما صحيحا ليس متأثرا بالثقافات الوافدة ولا بالافكار المستوردة، فكان قائما على الاتباع الخالص وعلى العبادة الحقة وعلى التصور الصادق بعيدا عن كل ما يكدر صفو الدين او يضعف بهاء الاسلام العظيم. والسلفية عندما نقول السلفية فاننا نعني به او بها المنهج الحق الذي يفهم فيه ذلك الدين، لا نعني بها او بهذا الاصطلاح فئة من الناس او في مكان معين او زمان معين، لان السلفية اعظم واجل من ان يحيط بها فئة من الناس في زمان معين او في مكان معين، وانما هي تشمل الدهر كله والمكان جميعه في الشرق والغرب في اطراف الدنيا وفي ارجاء المعمورة، يجمع كل من رضي بالله ربا وبالإسلام دينا وبمحمد صلى الله عليه وسلم نبيا ورسولا بالفطرة الصادقة والعلم الصحيح والمعرفة الواثقة والدقة في التصور السليم والقبول بمنهج السلف الصالحين حكما عدلا على الفهم لكتاب الله وسنة رسوله عليه الصلاة والسلام. فهي بهذا تترفع عن ان تكون حزبا او اطارا محدودا او دائرة ضيقة، بل هي الاسلام بشموله كله وبسعته جميعها.
The Sheikh continues by saying it is important for us to understand that when we state the word Salafiyya we are only meaning Islam. Islam, not other than al-Islam, or nothing that can be equal to al-Islam. For Islam, in our time and before our time, has been infiltrated by evil ideas and evil thoughts and evil actions and practices and misconceptions. And the only way to clarify these thoughts and misconceptions is to leave them behind and return back to the original people, those who received the original instructions from the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who were only concerned with living the greatness of al-Islam, enjoying the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not being concerned with anything else. So therefore we understand that the Salafiyya is a manhaj, it is a methodology of truth, manhajul haqq, in understanding the religion of al-Islam. And it is not a group of people in a certain place or in a certain time period. It is something that is from the beginning of the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam of al-Islam till the end of time. It is in every place and in every time. For those who have the true fitrah, who are raised upon the true teachings of al-Islam, who truly wish to submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who radu billahi rabban, who are content with Allah as their Lord, and the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as their Rasul, and with al-Islam as their religion. We must understand that the understanding of al-Islam must be derived from the Qur'an and from the Sunnah, and not just that, but it must be understood and implemented under the understanding of those who saw how it was implemented by the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam in its full completion, meaning the Sahaba and those who came after them in the next two generations.
ذكرنا أيها الأحباب الكرام المعول الأول من معاول الهدم الذي استخدمته الصوفية لتضل الناس عن دينهم. كان ذلك المعول في ادعاء الظاهر والباطن، أو الذي يسمى بمعنى آخر التأويل. أما المعول الثاني من معاول الهدم عند الصوفية التي عملت به في الإسلام، فهي أن هدمت عليهم السنة بعد هدم القرآن، وحاشاهم أن يستطيعوا ذلك، لأن الحافظ الذي يحفظ دين الإسلام هو الله قرآنا وسنة، بل ويحفظ المسلمين بحفظهم لذلك الدين. فبعد أن عرفنا من الإسلام أن الوحي ينزل على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بملك الوحي جبريل، فإذا بهؤلاء يطلعون على المسلمين يقولون: أنتم تأخذون دينكم ميتا عن ميت. يعني تقول، قال البخاري حدثنا الحميدي. أين البخاري وأين الحميدي؟ ويقول الحميدي حدثنا مالك. أين مالك؟ تأخذون دينكم ميتا عن ميت، ونحن نأخذ ديننا عن الحي الذي لا يموت، حدثني قلبي عن ربي ولا يوحي إليه إلا الشيطان. فقلبه ينقل الوحي عن الشيطان، واتخذ الشيطان ربا من دون الله رب العالمين.
Sheikh Safwat began by mentioning that we have discussed the first tool that the Sufiya began to use, which is placing doubts in regards to the Qur'an and its tafsir, by saying that there is an inner meaning and an outer meaning, and placing doubts or claiming ta'wil, that you can interpret it in such a way, mystical or philosophical way. He claims, the Sheikh now explains to us, there's also another tool. After they have attacked the Qur'an from such an angle, placing this doubt, they tried to destroy the Sunnah after attacking the Qur'an. But the Sheikh forcefully says, but Allah is the protector of the Qur'an and the Sunnah of His Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, for it has been promised to us. And in protecting the Qur'an and the Sunnah, Allah is therefore protecting the believers and their belief in Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Sufiyya, they began by saying, in regards to the hadith, after we understand that Jibreel came down to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with the message, they, after understanding this, they come and they say, you receive your religion dead person from dead person. As the Sheikh gave us the example, Al-Bukhari narrates that he heard from such, Al-Humaydi. And Al-Humaydi says he heard from Malik. And then they will ask you, but Al-Bukhari is dead, and Al-Humaydi is dead, and Malik is dead. You are receiving your religion dead person from dead person from dead person. As for us, they claim, they say, I receive my religion directly from the Lord. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ from Allah. They say, حَدَّثَنِي قَلْبِي عَنْ رَبِّي. My heart has instructed me as to what my Lord has instructed. And they are lying. For it is the shaytan who has placed this evil upon their hearts.
أما المعول الثالث فهو معول الالتزام بالتكاليف الشرعية. فالمسلم مكلف بالتكاليف الشرعية حتى الموت، واعبد ربك حتى يأتيك اليقين. أما أولئك الصوفية فيقولون العبد يبلغ بتعبده وذكره درجة تسقط عنه التكاليف الشرعية عندها، فيصبح غير مكلف بأوامر الشرع، فيفعل المعاصي وينتهي عن الطاعات لأنه سقطت عنه التكاليف. فانظر كيف جعلوا للقرآن بطنا فهربوا من معناه، وجعلوا لهم بالسنة وحيا فهربوا منها، وجعلوا التكاليف الشرعية عنهم ساقطة فهربوا منها. فإلى أين يهربون؟ ليس إلا إلى الكفر يخرجون. لذلك ينبغي أن نحذر من هذه المعاني التي خرج بها الباطنية من الصوفية، فإنهم باتفاق علماء الأمة ما أخذوا من تلك المناهج إلا الضلال والكفر، أجرنا الله وإياكم منه والكفر.
The Sheikh continued by saying, and as for their third tool, which is they have come to attack the actual worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the enforcing of the sharia of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and of al-Islam. As we know, Allah has stated, وَعَبُدْ رَبَّكَ حَتَّى يَأْتِيَكَ الْيَقِينَ, and stay involved in the worship of your Lord until your time of death has come, until your death arrives. So from the beginning of your life until the end of your life, you must be in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, obeying the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But what they say is that a human being can reach a level where no longer he must follow the sharia. He no longer has to pray, he no longer has to fast, he no longer has to give zakah, because he is at a level where these fall from him. He does not have to enforce them or follow them. And this is one of their claims. And the Shaykh, Hafidhahullah, he says, in the Quran, they placed a doubt. They tried to place a doubt. In the Sunnah, they tried to run away from it. And now from the Sharia and the obedience of Allah and the worship of Allah, they are also trying to escape. And what are they escaping to? He says, as for the batiniyya of the Sufiyya, with the consensus of the ulama, they are only escaping into the ideas that will lead them into dalal, misguidance, and into kufr or shirk.
ومن وجوه المقارنة بين الصوفية والسلفية، وإن قلنا أن المقارنة لا تصلح، لكن هي من باب إظهار الشيء وضده. كما قال الشاعر: الضد يظهر حسنه الضد، وبضدها تتميز الأشياء. فإذا وجد النور تذهب الظلمة، وإذا وجد الحق ينجلي الباطل. قل جاء الحق وزهق الباطل إن الباطل كان زهوقا. من أعظم الأمور التي تميز الصوفية، زيادة على ما ذكره فضيلة الشيخ في مصدر التلقي، ادعاء محبة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، فإنهم يصورون للناس أنهم أكثر الناس حبا للرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام، لذلك يعقدون مجالس الموالد التي يدعون فيها أن الرسول يحضر بينهم، ويعقدون مجالس الصلاة على النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام، ومن هذه الصلوات ما يسمى بصلاة الفاتح عند بعض الطرق الصوفية التي يقولون فيها من قرأ صلاة الفاتح مرة يكون خيرا ممن قرأ القرآن 6000 مرة. هذا من ضلالهم العريض، وقد غفلوا بل تغافلوا عن أن الحب الحقيقي دليله الاتباع، وأن المحبة الصادقة دليلها متابعة سنة رسول الله عليه الصلاة والسلام. والله عز وجل يقول: قل إن كنتم تحبون الله فاتبعوني يحببكم الله. فالسلفية تميزت بحمد الله باتباعها السنة، ولا يكون اتباع بغير محبة للنبي عليه الصلاة والسلام. تعصي الرسول وأنت تزعم حبه، إن المحب لمن يحب مطيع. لذلك فإن السلفية بتميزها بمنهجها القائم على الاتباع دلت دلالة أكيدة على أنها تعظم رسول الله وتحب رسول الله عليه الصلاة والسلام، وتضعه في منزلته التي نزله الله إياها، من غير أن يكون هنالك غلو في هذا الرسول الكريم عليه الصلاة والسلام الذي نهى أن يغلو فيه الناس، فإذا بالصوفية تغلو به وتضعه فوق موضعه وتزيده فوق منزلته. والسلفيون ملتزمون بالمحبة الحقيقية، قائمون بالاتباع الصادق على وفق سنة رسول الله عليه الصلاة والسلام.
The Sheikh Ali Al-Halabi, he begins by saying there can actually be no comparison between Sufi and Salafi, for the difference is too great. But what he says is, he gave a few verses of poetry. The meaning of them is that the opposite of something is known by the thing itself. For example, he gives us al-huda wal-dalal. If you know al-huda, if you have the guidance, you will be able to see the misguidance. So you can see the opposite of what you are on. Just like al-Islam, you are Muslim, you see that the opposite of you is something other. So therefore, to know something, you know it by what is opposite to it. As for the Sufis, he explains to us that they claim that they say they love one of the things that they do. They say that they love the Rasul Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam more than anyone else, and that they are the closest to him because of their love to him. And they will try to portray this by doing Milad, Miladun Nabi, or by doing any of these festivals or any of these festivities or celebrations that are not permitted in the Sharia of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Or for instance, they will say a salah, a type of prayer upon the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that they have created from their own selves. For one of them is called Salatul Fatih. And they claim that if you recite this salah on the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is, if you say it once, it is better than having recited the whole Quran 6,000 times. To say this so-called salah is better than to recite the whole Quran in its entirety 6,000 times. This is the misguidance that they are upon. They are forgetting what the true love of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is. It is the following in the exact footsteps of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Al-ittiba', full adherence to what he has advised us with, what he has ordered us to do, what he has shown us as an example. For Allah has said, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي. Say, if you truly love Allah, then follow me. يحببكم الله, then Allah shall love you ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم, and Allah shall forgive your sins, till the end of the ayah. The Shaykh also continued and says, following the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam is the true way of showing your love. Adherence to his sunnah, totally in submission to the actions of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, implementing them in that the Rasul is actually present with them. When they are making these salawat, that he will actually come and be present with them. Wal-iyadu billah. These are some of the effects of the misguidance that they are upon. The Sufiyya, they have performed ghulu. They have increased to the point where they should not have. While the people of Ahlul Sunnah, the Salafiyya, they give the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam his due rank, his proper place, following his sunnah, loving him more than we love our parents, our children, and anything else that we may possess. This is what we give while they give the bid'ah and others.
وعند الصوفية يدعون أنهم يذكرون الله عز وجل, وإن الذكر لهو من أهم وظائف المسلم, فالذكر رأس العبادات, فمنه الدعاء الذي هو العبادة, ومنه قراءة القرآن, ومنه التسبيح والتكبير والتحميد, ومنه الأذكار الموظفة في كل حال, فذكر الاستيقاظ من النوم والنوم في الفراش, وذكر خروج البيت والدخول إليه, وذكر الصباح والمساء, وغير ذلك من الأذكار المشروعة التي ينبغي للعبد أن يبقى لها ملتزمة, والتي أوصى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم رجلا من أصحابه بقوله لا يزال لسانك رطبا بذكر الله. دخلت الصوفية على باب الذكر فأفسدته على الناس, فذكروا بالاسم المفرد ثم بالاسم المحرف المنحول, فيدعون لأصحابهم أنهم يذكرون الله بلفظ من الألفاظ, لطيف 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 لطيف, ألف مرة, مئة ألف مرة, حي 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 حي, قيوم قيوم قيوم, ثم ينتقلون إلى اسم لم يسمى رب العزة به نفسه, وهو هو هو, هو. وقد ينتقلون إلى أسماء محرفة, فبدلا من أن ينطق لفظ الجلالة الله فيقول ها ها ها, حتى قال الشاعر فيهم ينبحون النبح كالكلاب, طريقهم ليست على الصواب, وليس فيهم من فتى مطيع, فلعنة الله على الجميع.
The Sheikh continues Muhammad Safwat Nuruddin by saying, another thing that the Sufis have mistaken in and fallen into misguidance in is in the actions that they may perform along with their so-called dhikr. As we know, dhikr is something that is an important job and duty upon every Muslim. It is from the head of the affairs that a Muslim must implement during his daily life. For as we know, falling under a dhikr is a dua, wa dua huwa al-ibada, dua is the worship, as the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. Also falling under dhikr is the recitation and the memorization of the Qur'an, where you will accept and receive many rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also under dhikr is at-tasbih, wa tahmid, wa tahleel, saying subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. Also memorizing and reciting the duas and the dhikr that the Rasul taught us for certain actions. When you wake up from sleep, before you go to sleep, what you say when you come near, when you are going to enter into your bed, exiting and entering your house, entering and exiting the masjid, day and night dhikr, these are all things that we as Muslims all perform. But as the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam instructed one of the Sahaba by saying, make sure that your tongue is never idle from making a dhikr.
is always in the process of praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of making this important form of ibadah. But yet we see that the Sufiyya, they change it. And they will sit in a gathering, for instance, and they will sit and they will, as you have just heard the Shaykh saying to you, they will use a single one of Allah's attributes, for example, Latif. And they will just sit there, Latif, 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 1,000 times. Maybe. No. Or, and even more, as Sheikh Al-Halabi says, thousands of times. And sometimes they will use something that isn't even part of the names of, or the attributes of Allah. They will use something that is not permitted. They will say, who, who, who. And they will continue doing this hundreds, thousands of times. Or they will just change the actual name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Instead of saying Allah, they will say Ha. And one of the poets, as the Shaykh has explained to us, I did not catch the full poem. He says, it's meaning they sound like one of the people who heard them do this. They make the sound of dogs. And none of them are in guidance. May the curse of Allah be upon those who participate in this. This is what the Sha'ir has said in regards to this action.
الإسلام من شرعه أنه بذكر الله تطمئن القلوب، ولكن هؤلاء بالذكر يتمايلون ويتراقصون، بل وعلى الطبول يذكرون، يذكرون الله عز وجل فيما يزعمون ذكرا لا تجل له القلوب ولا تطمئن له النفوس، إنما يذكرون أذكارا هي أقرب من الرقص. النبي علمنا الذكر بالجملة المفيدة التي فيها المدح والثناء على الله رب العالمين، فنقول الحمد لله، سبحان الله، لا إله إلا الله، الله أكبر، لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. أما هم فيذكرون الاسم المفرد الله الله، وهي لا تحمل مدحا ولا ذما، لا تعني آمنت بالله ولا كفرت بالله، حتى أن بعضهم سوى بين من ينطق بكلمة التوحيد ومن ينطق بكلمة الكفر. فانتبهوا حتى لا يختلط الأمر عندنا، لأن أهل البدع يلبسون ببدعهم، عساهم أن يأخذوا إلى حظيرة الشيطان صيدا ثمينا من أحدكم.
The Sheikh continued by saying, as for Islam, we realize from the sharia that has been given to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that dhikr allows the heart to be at rest. أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ. Your heart is at rest when you are in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But yet when you see them and the way they implement and they do their dance, as the Shaykh Hafidhullah has shown and has explained to us, you will see them using drums. You will see them dancing, twirling, doing things that will not place the heart at peace, will not allow you to be in peace in remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you will notice that when we, followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sunnah, when we make dhikr, we say Alhamdulillah, praise be to Allah, Subhanallah, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. But for them, they will only say Allah, Allah. It does not show any glory to Allah. It does not praise Allah. They are just saying the name. And some of them have even transgressed to the point where they will equate between the statement of Allah and the statement of kufr. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. It is as if you have said either one to them.
وَمِنْ أَعْظَمِ صور ذكر الله عز وجل، ومن أعظم ما يزيد صلة العبد بربه ويزكي به نفسه، استمرار الدعاء والابتهال والتضرع لرب الأرباب. فالأمر كما قال الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام
الدعاء هو العبادة. ثم تلا قوله تعالى وقال ربكم ادعوني استجب لكم ان الذين يستكبرون عن عبادتي سيدخلون جهنم داخرين. فالسلفيون في دعائهم يتوجهون الى الله يسألونه ويستغيثون به ويلهجون بذكره وييممون وجوههم نحوه، بل يعلمون ابناءهم وصغارهم ان الصلة بالله هي اعظم الصلات، وان دعاء الله هو اجل الدعوات، وان من دون الله ما يملكون من قطمير. فلقد صح في السنة ان النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام كان يقول، يعلم صغار الصحابة الذين لم ينبت الشعر على وجناتهم، يا غلام اني اعلمك كلمات، احفظ الله يحفظك، احفظ الله تجده تجاهك، اذا سألت فاسأل الله، واذا استعنت فاستعن بالله. فعاشوا على ذلك ونشأوا على ذلك وقاموا بذلك. اما الصوفية فماذا فعلوا؟ تركوا الله وصاروا يستغيثون بالاولياء، اعني باوليائهم هم الذين نصبوهم اولياء، فصاروا يسألونهم من دون الله ويستغيثون بهم عند الشدائد ويطلبون منهم المدد والعون، حتى كان بعض معاصرين من الصوفية الغلاء وكلهم كذلك يقول لمريديه اذا اصابتك مصيبة او المت بك ضائقة فقل فقط يا سيدي الشيخ تحل وتفرج. وهذا كله دليل على خواء نفوسهم من التزكية بادنى درجاتها، ومن التربية باقل مقاماتها، ومن العقيدة الصحيحة بادنى صورها ومظاهرها. وما اجمل تلكم القصة التي ذكرها العلامة صديق حسن خان من علماء الهند الكبار، لما حج في السفينة من الهند ذاهبا الى جدة ليذهب هنالك الى مكة للحج، قال فأصاب السفينة من موج البحر ورياحه ما جعلها كالريشة في مهب الريح. فإذا بكثير من الصوفية الذين أرادوا الحج على تلك السفينة نفسها يقولون يا سيدي فلان يا سيدي فلان، يستغيثونه يستغيثون أولياءهم من دون الله ويطلبون المدد من سوى الله. قال العلامة الشيخ صديق حسن خان فلما رأيت ذلك رفعت يدي الى السماء وقلت يا رب اغرق هذه السفينة فما بقي احد من الناس يعرفك. لماذا؟ لان قلوبهم موصولة بغير الله تبارك وتعالى. فكانوا على مثل ما كان عليه الكفار بل اكثر. فالكفار كانوا اذا ركبوا في الفلك دعوا الله مخلصين له الدين، هؤلاء اذا ركبوا في الفلك تركوا الله ويمموا وجوههم نحو غيره، وما ذلك الا لفساد ما هم عليه من اعتقاد وتزكية وتصور.
الشيخ علي حسن begins by saying all of us know that the best and one of the best actions in dhikr is a dua. It is to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wholeheartedly and asking him for his help and his protection, supplicating to him subhanahu wa ta'ala, following the advice of the messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he said ad-du'a huwa al-ibadah, dua is the worship, and then recited from Surah Ghafir, he recited special song. No. وقال ربكم ادعوني استجب لكم. And your Lord has proclaimed and has said, ask me and I shall answer you for anything. استجب لكم. إن الذين يستكبرون عن عبادتي سيدخلون جهنم داخرين. As for those who turn and scorn and look down upon my worship, meaning الدُّعَاء, they shall be entered into the fire in humiliation. The Salafis, we know, in dua we ask only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For only Allah can we plead to Him. Only to Him can we turn for help. Only to Him can we rely upon. We even teach it to our children following the advice and the action of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he used to teach the young Sahaba, those who didn't have beards yet, Ya Ghulam, he would tell them, my son, احفظ الله يحفظك, guard Allah's limits and Allah shall guard you. احفظ الله تجده تجاهك, guard Allah's limits and you shall find Him before you. إذا سألت فاسأل الله, if you will ask anyone, ask only Allah. وإذا استعنت فاستعن بالله, and you, if you will put reliance in something, put your reliance only in Allah. We see when we compare these actions of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam to what is being done by the Sufis today, they will leave off the asking of Allah. And they will ask and call unto their so-called awliya. And as the Shaykh said, some of them even living today will tell their pupils, their students, if you are in any distress, raise your hands and say, oh my master, ya Shaykh, help me. This is what they teach their students, not to rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not to make dua to Allah, to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are far away from the aqidah that was institutionalized, that was taught to us, that we derive from the Qur'an and from the sunnah and the understanding of a salaf as-salih. The Shaykh gives us a quick and a very enlightening story from one of the great ulama, Siddiq Hasan Khan. He was a person who was coming to Mecca to perform Hajj, and he was riding on a ship. He was traveling by ship. And it so happened that they were caught in the middle of a storm. And the people who were traveling with him from India, some of them who were Sufi, raised their hands, making dua, saying, Ya Sidi, Ya Sheikh, oh my master, oh my Sheikh, making this dua. And Siddiq Hasan Khan, rahimahullah, with his tawheed, with his iman, with his yaqeen in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he raised his own hands to Allah and he made dua and he said, oh Allah, do not allow anyone who performs such an action to survive this voyage. And the ship sank. And the ship sank. We see, Ya Ibadallah, as the Shaykh has said, the kuffar in this same situation, Allah described them. When they are in this situation and the waves are playing with their boat, they would ask Allah, if you return us to safety, to land, if you return us to land, we will worship you. This is what they'll say. But yet these people, they will ask other than Allah, even in this situation.
ومن المعاني التي أفسدتها الصوفية على المسلمين معنى الولاية. والولاية كلمة تحمل في طياتها المحبة والنصرة. فمن أحب الله ونصره فقد والاه. من أطاع الله في السر والعلن وأسلم له القلب والبدن فقد والاه. فرب العزة يقول, ألا إن أولياء الله لا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون الذين آمنوا وكانوا يتقون. فتلك هي الولاية الشرعية. والولاية الطاعة والاتباع في سائر التكاليف المشروعة.
بينما الولاية في الإسلام معروفة بهذا، فإن الصوفية قلبتها قلبا شديدا. فالأولياء أتباع للرسل والأنبياء، والرسل خواص الأنبياء، بعثهم رب العزة إلى الخلق برسالات. فبهذا نفهم أن الرسل أعلى من الأنبياء، وأن الأنبياء يعلمون الناس فيصبح منهم أولياء. ومع ذلك فإنهم يقولون، الصوفية يقولون، ومقام النبوة في برزخ دون الولي، فويق الرسول ودون الولي، ومقام النبوة في برزخ فويق الرسول، فويق يعني فوقه بقليل، ودون الولي، فيجعلون الولي أعلى من النبي وأعلى من الرسول. فانظروا إلى الإسلام كيف رتب الأمور، وكيف جاءت الصوفية لتعكس ذلك.
Sheikh Muhammad Safwat continues our discussion by saying, other meanings that have been changed by the Sufiyya is the understanding of wilaya, or loyalty, or companionship, or protection. Loyalty, I think, would be the best word. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, أَلَا إِنَّ أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. As for the helpers of Allah's cause, the loyal to Allah's cause in helping the cause of Islam, they shall have no fear and no sorrow. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, what are their description that we have in the Quran? They are those who believe, وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ, and who are full of piety and taqwa and the consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For them they shall have no fear and no sorrow. For they used to live by the laws of Allah, loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and worshipping Him the way He was intended to be worshipped and the way He had the haqq to be worshipped subhanahu wa ta'ala. As for us, we believe that the wali are under the anbiya, for the prophets and the rusul are the ones who come with al-Islam. And after they have spread al-Islam, the rusul, after they have spread al-Islam, the awliya, they are like the revivers. They are the ones who are the practice of our Islam, the mu'minun and the muttaqun, those who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and have full reliance in Him and fear Him. The rusul are higher and the anbiya are higher than the awliya in our aqeedah. As for the sufiyya, now we see, they say, and these are some poetry that they are used to saying, the understanding of it, and the prophethood, the station of prophethood is higher than messengership and less than being a wali. So they place that the awliya are the highest thing, higher than the prophets and higher than the messengers, although they are the ones who were chosen by Allah to bring the risala to the earth, to bring the risala and the tawheed. And this is where the Shaykh Hafidhahullah stopped off.
الولاية عند الصوفية طابع يعتبرونه صكا يزعمون أن الله عز وجل أعطاه لأناس وإن كانوا فسقة أو فجرة. فهم يظنون أن الأولياء مندسين بين الناس لا يعرفون، أي لا يعرفون بطاعة ولا أمر معروف ولا نهي عن منكر، إنما ينسبون لكثير من ولاتهم السرقة والزنا والسجود للأصنام وغير ذلك، وينسبون إلى بعضهم أنه خرج من الدنيا ومن التكاليف فيها ليفعل أفعالا ليست من أفعال العقلاء، كأن يكون أحدهم يبقى عاما لا يمس بدنه الماء، فلا هو يتوضأ ولا يغتسل، فكيف إذن يصلي؟ وينسبون إلى بعضهم أنه كان في الفسق والمعاصي منغمسا وجاريا، ثم به مرة واحدة يرتفع إلى مقام أولى الأولياء الذين يلتزم الأولياء بأمره ويطيعون إشارته ويقفون عند نهيه. يذكرني ذلك بما ادعته المسيحية في بولس الذي كان يسمى شاول، والذي كان يعادي المسيح ما بقي حيا على الأرض. فلما رفع المسيح جاء بولس يدعي للناس أن المسيح قد ظهر له، وأنه قال له: شاول شاول، لماذا تضطهدني؟ إنك لا تستطيع أن تطفئ ضوء الشمس. قال له: ماذا تريد يا سيدي؟ قال: اذهب فكرز مع التلامذة بالإنجيل. فإذا به يذهب مرة واحدة ليصير أعظم رسل المسيح وأكثر من تنسب إليه التعاليم، فدخل بذلك على المسيحية فأفسدها، فأبطل ما جاء به المسيح وحرف التعاليم التي جاء بها. فكذلك الصوفية جاءت تريد أن تحرف علينا أمر ديننا.
Sheikh Safwat continues by saying, Wilaya with some Sufis, to them it can be a person who is in the act of disobeying Allah, not worshipping Allah, in a state of total impurity, a deviant. Any of these people, they can be wali, but you do not know. They can be people that you know or do not know, unknown people walking in the streets. You may think that they are something else, unclean as such, but they in fact are wali. This is what they claim. Some of them have even come to the point where they say, to clarify the point, not known. Also, the Sheikh points out that they are not known to have ever ordered any good and never forbade any evil, never called people to Islam, never forbade people from committing evil acts. Some of them may be performing and indulging in things not even befitting humans. Some of them will claim and they will perform that they will say, water shall not touch my body for a full year. A full year, he will not touch water upon his body. So how will he perform wudu? How can he be from the believers who fear Allah? The Shaykh explained to us, he gives us an example. He said, in Christianity, you can see how their Sufis entered and destroyed their religion. He gives us the example of Paul, who claimed that he saw Jesus after his so-called death, and that Jesus ordered him to gather the disciples and to gather them and to produce a Bible. He came and he claimed this. This was his claim. And from that day on, this claim has been to the day we are living today. So this is a way that the doubts are placed into the hearts of the believers in our times and the times that have come before us.
Allah al-Hafiz حفظ لنا ديننا بحفظه، فلم تستطع الصوفية أن تغطي معالمه ولا أن تخفي جماله، بينما استطاع بولس أن يخفي معالم النصرانية على الناس فتنسب معظم النصرانية إليه، ويبقى القرآن والسنة محفوظان بحفظ الله. الصوفية تدعي في أوليائها أنهم يعلمون الغيب، والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يأمره ربه أن يقول للناس: قل لو كنت أعلم الغيب لاستكثرت من الخير وما مسني السوء. فالملائكة لا يعلمون الغيب لأنهم لما عرضت عليهم الأسماء قالوا سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا، مع أن آدم قد تعلمها. وكذلك الأنبياء لا يعلمون الغيب، والجن لا يعلمون الغيب، والبشر لا يعلمون الغيب، والصوفية تدعي في أوليائها أنهم يعلمون الغيب، بل وتدعي في أوليائها أنهم يقرؤون من اللوح المحفوظ، وتدعي للولاية خاتما اختلفوا في تعيينه، وتدعي أن خاتم الأولياء أفضل من خاتم الأنبياء، خسئوا بما قالوا وبما اعتقدوا. فالحمد لله على نعمة التوحيد ونعمة الإسلام، الحمد لله حمى دينه وأبقاه، فتمسكوا واحتفظوا بما جاءكم من القرآن والسنة، بما جاءكم عن سلف الأمة، ينجيكم الله عز وجل.
The Sheikh completes and says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Hafiz, has protected our religion and shall continue to do so, protecting al-Islam until the day of Qiyamah, protecting its beauty and its completeness and its simplicity. It will not be like the Christians, as Paul, we have just shown, has done, where the Bible, most of it is narrated by him, or it is a statement of him, or a statement of others, while the Qur'an is the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without a doubt. We see that the Sufis, they also claim that they know the unseen, al-ghayb. They know what shall happen in the future. Their awliya, they say, have the ability to know the unseen in the future. While we see that Allah tells His Messenger in the Qur'an, tell the disbelievers if you are questioned, if I knew the unseen, I would only take what is good. I would only receive good. I would only do the things that would bring good to me. And I would never fall into doing something that shall bring evil or hardship to me. We see that the malaika, the angels, also do not know al-ghayb. They say when Allah questions them, Subhanaka, لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا. Glory be to you, O Allah. We have no knowledge except what you have taught us. But yet, you find that the Sufiyin, they claim, we know the unseen. We know what is in the alwah. They say they know what is in the book that is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the type of deviancy that they are upon. And the Shaykh, he concluded by making dua and reminding us and you to be steadfast and to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, continue asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save you from ever being dragged or have doubt placed in your heart as to what the true aqidah is or what the true manhaj is. Allahumma ameen.
هنا أيها الإخوة في الله نقطة لعلها تكون الأخيرة قبل أن نفتح المجال لشيء من السؤال، وهي أن نعلم في نهاية هذه الجولة بين التزكية السلفية والخرافات الصوفية، أن نعلم الثمرة التي نتجت عن التزكية عند أهل السنة، والثمرة التي نتجت عن هذه الخرافات التي تسمى تصوفا عند الصوفية. أما السلفيون فعندهم نتيجة هذه التزكية كلها تحقيق العبودية لله، ليكون العبد عبدا ذليلا محتاجا إلى ربه العظيم الجليل، وليكون الرب إلها عظيما تذل له المخلوقات وتخضع له الكائنات. بينما الصوفية لم ينتج عندهم إلا الحلول والاتحاد ووحدة الوجود والفناء بين الخالق والمخلوق، حتى قال قائلهم العبد رب والرب عبد، يا ليت شعري من المكلف. لا يعلمون الخالق من المخلوق، ولا يعلمون الرب من المربوب.
فإذا بالمدرسة الأولى مدرسة السنة وأهل السنة، مدرسة السلف والسلفية، يخرج منها رجال أبرار وعلماء أخيار كالإمام أحمد والشافعي وشيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية وابن القيم وابن رجب والإمام محمد بن عبد الوهاب وغيرهم ممن قبل وبعد، ممن ساروا على ذلك النهج الصافي والطريق الوافي. وإذا بمدرسة التصوف يكون منها ابن الفارض وابن عربي والبسطامي وغير هؤلاء أو وغير هؤلاء الذين يقول الواحد منهم ما الكلب والخنزير إلا إلى هنا وما الله إلا راهب في كنيسته، لأنهم يؤمنون بوحدة الوجود، أن كل ما أمامك هو الله فلا فرق عندهم بين الرب والعبد، وهذا عين الكفر بالله. والإسلام بحمد الله من هذا كله بريء، وقد تنبه علماء الإسلام لهذه الخرافات وهذه الزيوف التي وردتنا من الأديان المحرفة السابقة ومن الحضارات الزائلة الزائفة كالهندوك والزردشت وغير هؤلاء، لتوضع باسم الإسلام ولتكون تحت اسم الإسلام. ولكن الله عز وجل يهيئ لهذا الدين حملة عدولا، كما قال الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام: يحمل هذا العلم من كل خلف عدوله، ينفون عنه تحريف الغالين وانتحال المبطلين وتأويل الجاهلين. وهذا ما وفق الله إليه السلفيين ليكشفوا عنه زيف الصوفيين وغيرهم من المبتدعين، والله ولي الصالحين.
Sheikh Ali al-Halabi continues and completes our discussion in the comparison of the two of tazkiyah of the Salafiyyah and the tazkiyah or the so-called tazkiyah of the Sufiyyah. He says we must understand the tazkiyah of the Salafiyyah by looking at its fruits, what we derive from it. We see first of all tawheed al-ubudiyya lillah. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is worshipped. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is relied upon. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is called upon. All reliance is put in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Unifying and singling out only Allah in worship. Seeking only Allah's pleasure. Humility in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. While we see in their side, in the Sufiyyah, they have وحدة الوجود or الاتحاد, where they will claim that Allah Azza wa Jal, they claim, will enter into the body of a human and that he can be with him, enter upon him, be one together. And you will hear from their poetry where they slay, the slave is nothing less than the Lord and the Lord is only a slave. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. But yet we see from those of Ahlul Sunnah, from those who follow the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, like al-Imam Ahmad wa al-Shafi'i, wal-Imam ibn Taymiyyah, wal-Imam ibn al-Qayyim, wa ibn Rajab, wa ibn Abdul Wahhab, and others that the Shaykh has named, and others he has not, all of them are in the unifying and singling out only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship. Removing any of these doubts that the Sufiyyah may place in al-Islam. And others, they will say, when you look at their side, they have people like Ibn Arabi and al-Bustami, who will make claims and they will say, when you look at a dog or a pig, you are only looking at your Lord. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. This is their claim. The khinzir, the dog, this is their Lord. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. These are the claims that they make. And the Shaykh concluded by mentioning to us an important hadith where he explains to us that al-Islam, that the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has described that for this ummah, there will always be people who will be following the just and the right path, correcting what others may have strayed away from and staying on the correct and true path, Siratullah al-Mustaqim. And he makes dua that may we all be upon this path. وَجَزَاهُ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا. And this is where the Shaykh had concluded. Tariq. Inshallah, we will, if there are any questions that you may have written, in order that we will have enough time, there are 15 minutes before we call up Shaykh Al-Uthaymeen, inshallah. The first question, I would like to know the meaning. What is your opinion regarding befriending and trusting one who has openly proclaimed that they are Sufi?
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. بعض الناس أحسنوا الظن بأهل المناهج الباطلة كالصوفية وغيرهم، ولذا فإنه يجب علينا أن نعرف ذلك التعريف الذي يزيل عنه الجهالة ويمنع عنه العذر، وأن نصبر على ذلك صبرا طويلا، لأن محاربة البدع محاربة عسيرة تحتاج إلى علم واسع وحكمة دقيقة وصبر طويل.
The Sheikh, he explains that we must place a great deal of effort and a great deal of time in calling this brother back, keeping a link with the brother in order to not let him get further and deeper into this, and to keep a tie with him and call him with al-hikmah, with wisdom, while we ourselves are aloof, that we do not fall into what this brother may be calling to, or what this person may be performing, or this person may be attempting to do. Tafaddal.
Yeah, my question to Sheikh is that in back home, there is a verse in the Quran which says, لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ نُورٌ وَكِتَابٌ مُبِينٌ. The people, they explain this verse that نور, that is Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَكِتَابٌ مُبِينٌ means the Quran. So their meaning is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not the Bashar, but he is the Nur, like the angels and the